Good to see all of you here this morning. I'm glad you're here worshiping with us here in the building. And I also want to welcome those who are visiting online with us this morning in our Facebook Live feed. And for those who don't know, if you want to share it with someone, we also will be on YouTube about an hour after the service is over. It'll get uploaded to YouTube as well. So you can have some friends or family, if they don't do Facebook or for some reason don't use Facebook, you can tell them to catch us on YouTube. But I want to just welcome all of you here today. I know we have at least one visitor with us today. Is there anybody else besides Miss Janine, I think it is, right? Janine, okay, I'm sorry. She's visiting with us for the first time today. Is there anybody else? Anybody else for the first time? First time in a long time? Okay. Well, we're glad you're here with us today, Miss Denine. And those of you who are worshiping online with us, we would tell all of you that we're glad you're here. And you could have worshiped anywhere else you wanted to. You have that freedom, right? But you chose to be here with us today, and for that, we are honored that you're here. And we pray that all of us, as we worship the Lord together, that it'll be an immense blessing to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to just make a couple of announcements before we actually get into our service today. And first of all, I want to remind you that April 26th, which is tomorrow, Monday, 9 a.m., Lifeline screening is going to be coming in, and it'll be in our fellowship hall, affordable health care screening. They do great work. If you've got any questions, please call our office and talk to Teresa about it. On May the 9th, we're going to have, as is our custom, on Mother's Day, we have baby dedication, child dedication service during the morning service. So if you have children that you have not already publicly dedicated and you'd like to do so on Mother's Day, May the 9th, please call our office and let Teresa know. No later than April the 28th. And so that way we can get all of the things that we need to accumulate for you in the packet that we want you to have from us on that baby dedication day. It's not a day where we baptize the child, as some do when they reach a certain age, some other faiths and denominations, but it's a day where we dedicate the baby and the parent, or the parents, to Christ. We give that baby to the Lord and ask that the Lord give us guidance as a church family and mom and dad to raise that child to know Christ at an early age. Then I invite you to join us on Thursday evenings. We're still doing the Zoom study on Thursday evening. I thought about where we were going to go with this in the few weeks ahead, and so I need to talk to a few people because I have a little idea that I want to run past them. But for right now, we're going to be on Zoom for our weekly prayer meeting and Bible study on Thursday evenings at 6:30, and you will get a link to that in your email a day or two before, and you can get on. It's real easy to join us. So I invite you to join us in that Zoom meeting every Thursday night. We don't have the Saturday night meeting anymore. Saturday night was a Sunday school meeting that Brother Don was teaching. And now that we are back in Sunday school, that meeting on Saturday night we're no longer having. But we are still having the Thursday night, 6:30, and I hope you will join. And then let me remind you again, we started back with our Sunday evening services last week. And we had a good time in here last Sunday night as we're looking at David Barton's study about our United States history. What did our founding fathers really intend? What did they actually say in the letters that they wrote? And he's bringing all of that out in these DVD video studies that we're watching. And we'll watch part one and part two tonight. I forget the name of it, but it's understanding how our godly principles are the basis of our nation's laws, or something of that nature. But he's telling us all the things that we haven't been taught in our history schools in the last two or three generations. And I want you to come and really get a good grab on what our true history is. It'll change a little bit about what you're thinking about what's going on out there in the world today. So I invite you to come do that. Also, you have there in your possession, this is from Christ-Centered Solution. We actually support Dr. Rod West. He was pastor over at Friendship Baptist Church for a long, long time. And but the Lord called him out into full-time counseling. He got his credentials, and that's what he does full-time. He's 2 days down here each week and 3 days in North Carolina. We, as other churches do, we support him monthly with our tithes and offerings, a percentage of it. And so I'm asking you, if you will, to read through that. There are some single, well, let me just read the front half of it there. He was telling me the other day, and this is what was in my email, we have two single moms with small children who are in need of help. These mothers have reached out to Christ-Centered Solutions through the referral of other Christians. Both are seeking biblical counsel, which we are providing at a substantially reduced rate. Yet even with the reduced rate, it is a struggle for them, and they insist on contributing to their care. Their legal fees, along with their other financial responsibilities, are piling up. And what I would like to do is to tell them that other Christ followers have covered their care for CCS, so they can now apply the funds they were paying in other areas. Can you help us, he's asking, with these single moms, with an extra donation to Christ-Centered Solutions this month? Sweetie Pie and I went online when he first sent this to me. And I think as you go on there, they're needing about $1,000 to cover all the counseling and some other things for these moms. And we gave online, I think it was Friday, and you can do the same thing, or you can use one of the offering envelopes in the back and designate it to CCS, Christ-Centered Solutions, for these moms. And any little bit that you might be able to give, he's asking all of us who are board members for his ministry to ask our churches about it. And so we're doing that this morning. And if the Lord allows you and you want to give to help relieve some of that financial responsibility on some of these single moms, then please you do that this morning, designate it, or go to his website, which is ChristCenteredSolutions.org. ChristCenteredSolutions.org. All right. With that being said, I'm going to ask my brother, Deacon William Borges, if he'll come up here this morning. I think he's going to have our opening invocation. Well, there he is. But he's going to have our invocation. And then after that, we're going to sing, followed by Brother David Luther, who come and read our passage of scripture out of Mark. So, brother, you come pray for us.
It's a good day in the house of the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for bringing us here to the house, brothers and sisters together. We praise you to honor you and to glorify your name.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
Good morning. It is so good to be here this morning in the house of God. These past few weeks have been a struggle for me, vocally speaking, and it's because of the weather, the climate. But I always have a passion, and I still have a passion, and I know that this is God's gift. It's not my gift, and I use it for God's honor and glory. And I am so glad to be here this morning to praise and worship God with you guys. And not only that, but just think about, we all have a purpose, a divine purpose. for God and God's work. You may not know what it is, but God knows what it is. And if you ask him, God, use me, he will show you the way. And sometimes Satan knows where God is going to use us. So Satan is going to put obstacles in our life. He's going to put hurdles that we have to jump through. And we can only do that with God by our side. Amen. And this morning, I invite you and I ask you just to raise your hallelujah with me. Because I know I can't do it for you. I can raise my own hallelujah. But each and every one of us has to do that. And in order for us to do that, we just ask you, God, please, this morning, I'm going to lift my hands to you, and I'm going to raise my hallelujah as hard and as high as I can for you to use me in your will. Amen.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praise more. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Woo! Yes, Jesus, hallelujah. We raise our hallelujahs to you.
I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a in the middle of a storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
He is alive, yes, hallelujah.
Everybody sing this.
Sing a little louder.
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 Oh, sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing
a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm, louder and louder. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah.
Sing it.
I raise a hallelujah.
Holy, hallelujah.
Amen.
We welcome the Holy Spirit this morning. We feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the Holy Spirit, for the counselor, Lord, that you have sent for us, Jesus. And with that same motion and with that same spirit, hallelujah, let us sing, He is our living hope. Amen.
Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim
yours, here's the victory. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. God, you are my living hope.
Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah. God, you are our living hope. Yes, you are, Jesus. And we know that through all of our circumstances, through all the trials, we know that God was always faithful and he will do it again. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. Oh, touch us, Jesus. Anoint us, Lord. We come before you, Jesus, asking you for your fresh touch.
Change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet.
Your promise, Jesus.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come. My heart will sing your praise again.
Yes, it will. Jesus.
Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise. Your promise still stands. Great is thy faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
You've never, never failed me, Lord, ever.
Thank you.
seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You see you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed.
Sing it to him.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. You've never failed me yet. And I never will.
Amen.
Would you remain standing as Brother David comes and has our morning scripture reading?
Good morning, church family. As we continue to worship this morning, let us worship in the written word. Reading this morning from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Beginning of the gospel is of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way. The voice of the one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the countries of Judea was going out to him, and all of the people of Jerusalem, and they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. And John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist, and his diet was locusts and wild honey. And he was preaching and saying, "After me, one is coming who is mightier than I, and I am not fit to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." And it came about in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And immediately coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him.
Praise Jesus, hallelujah.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can be suffer.
Well, if that didn't bless you, your blesser's worn out. You need to get a new one. Amen? All right. This morning, we're going to continue our way through the book of Mark. And I gave you all a disclaimer last week about it will be a while before we actually get through the book of Mark. And I mentioned to you last week, the rapture might come before we get finished. And that'll be okay too, right? Amen? But I want to make sure, especially in this first chapter and primarily the first 8 to 10 verses, I want to make sure that I lay down a good foundation, because it will determine what you get in the rest of this book, all right? So I'm going to start today, as I said, in verses 1, and I have 10 that I had David read, but I can promise you we won't get that far today, okay? In fact, today and the next 3 weeks, we're looking at God's very first gospel preacher. And I'm going to do this in 4 parts. This is part 1 today. We'll be looking at these first 8 to 10 verses during that 4 weeks time frame. And we're going to see that preacher, who is John the Baptist, we're going to see that preacher more in the next 3 weeks. But first of all, again, I want to set all of that up with this part 1 of 4. Now, you've probably heard the name. Let me share with you this illustration to begin with. You've probably heard the name somewhere in your past, Florence Chadwick. Florence Chadwick was a phenomenal swimmer. At the age of 10, she became the youngest person ever to swim across 6 miles of the San Diego Bay. When she was 31 years old, she swam the entire English Channel twice, which spans from England to France, and she set speed records both ways, swimming 14 consecutive hours. When she was 52 years old, she encountered perhaps her greatest challenge of her career. She decided she was going to swim the cold and choppy Pacific waters between Catalina Island and the coastline of California. That's 26 grueling, agonizing miles. Even the greatest younger swimmers in that day, with tremendous skills, they say that it's one of the most difficult swims that you could ever imagine. After about 13 hours into that swim, fog rolls in, begins to envelop her. It's everywhere. She's got a crew there with her, you know, that are following her. Some are protecting her from sharks. Others are there to encourage her. Some are there to help pull her from the water if she needs help. So she's looking all around, and later she said she couldn't even see 1 meter in front of her. So with this fog, as she's swimming along, she becomes discouraged. She becomes disappointed, and before long she's thinking, I don't believe that I'm going to make this. And she cries out to her team, guys, I think I'm done. But then she swims for another hour, but finally she says, okay, pull me out of the water. And so as they sat in the boat, and the fog began to clear and dissipate around her, she realized that she was less than a half a mile from the shoreline. In an interview the next day, she said that all I could see was the fog. I couldn't see anything else. I wasn't defeated by the fatigue. I was defeated by the fog. And then she said these profound words. I think if I could have seen the shore, I would have made it. Well, in fact, 2 months later, she decided to do it again. And what was incredible was this. About the same time, she was 13 hours in, the same type of fog, that thick, dense fog was all around her again. And so again, she had a choice. But this time, she powered through. She continued on. She persevered. And she made it to the other side. And someone asked her, later, what was the difference between those two swims? Why could she make it this time and not make it the last time, even though they were identical circumstances? And Florence Chadwick said these words, I had in my mind a mental picture of the shoreline,
And so what I did is I fixated on where I was going rather than what was going on around me. Florence Chadwick understood the power of keeping her eyes on the prize, as the Apostle Paul speaks of in Philippians chapter 3. He says, I strain to reach the end of the race and receive the prize for which God is calling us up to heaven because of what Christ Jesus did for us. The power of being able to see where you're going, keeping your eyes focused on where you're going in the midst of the fog of life. She found that out. I thought about a new bumper sticker, you know, one that just says, fog happens, you know, because it does. Now, let me say this. I know I don't look like it right now, but I was a pretty good athlete in high school and into college. In baseball, I remember my coach telling me to never look at where the ball that I hit was going, but I was to look ahead and run as fast as I could to reach first base. In football, as a quarterback, when I would drop back to throw a pass, it wasn't until I learned to take my eyes off of what was going on around me at the line of scrimmage. I mean, those guys are screaming and hollering and kicking and biting one another, you know. Well, it wasn't until I got my eyes off of that and fixed them on the receivers downfield that I became a fairly effective passer. As a runner on the track team, my coach taught me to not look back to see who was chasing me or to see how close they might be, but to keep my eye on the finish line while I ran as fast as I could to reach it. I remember him telling me, every time you're running and you have to look back, it slows you down. I was taught over and over and over, don't look around you, don't look behind you, get your eyes fixed on the finish line and go. And it's interesting to me that the same type of spiritual coaching for Christians is right in our scriptures. Hebrews chapter 12 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So get your eyes off the circumstances. Get your eyes off the fog around you and get your eyes focused on Jesus. And why? Why do we do that? Because the circumstances will slow you down. The circumstances around you are going to hinder you. Because here's the deal. Fog will happen. Can I get a witness? In life, just like Florence Chadwick in the water, for Christians, fog happens in life. And you know what? Fog can be busyness. It can be grief. Fog can be tragedy. Fog can be financial woes. Fog can be marital issues. Fog could be the Gamecocks losing or the Tigers winning. Fog comes in all kinds of ways. Number of things. But the fog will just happen. And my friend, listen. It comes out of nowhere. Oftentimes, you don't even see it coming. Now, what we often do, and let me tell you this, I'm speaking from experience here on this, okay? What we often do is we get our eyes on the fog, we get our eyes on the circumstances, we get fixed on the problem or the setback or the crisis, or even get our eyes fixed on the unknown, things that we can't even think for, we don't know yet. And when we do that, we get disoriented, we get delusional and discouraged, we even get depressed. And oftentimes, I'll tell you, by experience again, we want to just quit. We want to throw in the towel. But the scriptures say, the scriptures, you know what I'm talking about, the ones we say we believe, the scriptures. You know, the ones we say amen to, the scriptures say, get your eyes off the fog, get your eyes off the circumstances. Stop paying attention to the things going on around you or even behind you and fix your eyes on the shoreline, on the prize. Fix your eyes on Jesus. And why Jesus? Because he is the prize. He's the finish line. He's the goal. He's the reward. He is the prize. Get your eyes fixed on Jesus because he is the object of all of our aspirations. Look at that verse that's up on the screen there again, Hebrews 12, 1. Now, if we read over that real quickly, you're going to miss two or three things that I want you to see. And while I'm here, with this. Let me briefly show them to you. First of all, Paul says that there are a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us. What does that mean? Well, the implication is that they're watching us. But who are these great cloud of witnesses watching us? Several Bible commentaries affirm a dual usage there of the word cloud. First, it's connected to chapter 11. You know how I know that it's connected to chapter 11? Because you see the first word there of Hebrews 12:1? Therefore. That means whatever is going on back there in chapter 11 is pertinent to what Paul's about to say right now. All of this in chapter 11, therefore, okay? And who's being talked about? Who's referred to in chapter 11? Well, it's those saints. It's believers who've gone on before us into heaven. In fact, we call chapter 11 in the Bible the Hall of Faith chapter, as Paul refers to the faith of Enoch and Noah and Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Rahab, Samson, David, Samuel. So he means we're being watched from heaven by all those before us who died in Christ and have gone on before us. All who died looking forward to Christ. So listen, the countless thousands of God's faithful throughout the ages, they now sit in the grandstands of eternity observing Christians as they seek to live for Christ in this world. And you know what? I believe they're rooting for us. I believe they are. Our loved ones, even who have gone on that we have lost in this life, ourselves, they're... If they died in the Lord, I believe they're rooting for us right now. They're in that cloud of witnesses that are watching us. But listen to this too. That word cloud can also mean a throng of people, referring to the witnesses all around us right now, the lost and the saved that are watching how we run this race every day. I'm talking about the living, breathing people around us. And listen, how you run the race will either encourage or discourage other Christians. And also, listen, how you run the race will either draw people to Jesus or it will push them away from Jesus. There's no neutral ground. May I tell you that? I probably told you that 100 times in the years I've been here. There's no sitting on the fence with the Lord Jesus Christ. He said either you're with me or you're against me. You're gathering with me or you're scattering abroad is what he said. And so... How you run the race is going to either draw people to Jesus or push them away. All right, the other thing I don't want you to skip over in Hebrews chapter 12 is this. Look at the end of verse 1. It says, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Now, let me state the obvious, okay? But I want to be sure that we're all on the same page here, all right? Your race is not my race. And my race is not your race. Each of us has our own unique race to run. Oh, the goal is the same. The prize is the same. You see what I'm saying? That shoreline, that Jesus that we fix our eyes on, that's the same for all of us. But your race and how God lines it up for you to run it is different from the way that he lines it up for me to run. Each of us has our own unique race to run. God has a plan and a purpose for your life and for mine, and it's ultimately different from the plan that he has for everyone else's life. Do we get that now? Do we understand that? That's why he calls so many. The Bible speaks of 19 different gifts of the Spirit. He calls us into certain areas, and I don't just mean preaching and teaching. I'm talking about whatever your giftedness is, God expects you to use that in the body of Christ, in the church. I don't think that's too much to ask for us to use the gifts that he's given us in the church, since he's the one who climbed all the way up that hill, Golgotha, and crawled on that cross and died in my place. Certainly it's not too much for him to ask that we use the gifts for his glory and to grow the kingdom of God while we're here. So we all have our own unique race to run that's different. And then, always there's some who might say, well, preacher, I really don't know what God's plan is for my life. I don't know what God's purpose is for my life. Well, you're probably not alone in that. I believe very few Christians can tell you what God's purpose is for their lives. And sadly, here's the reason why. God will never, listen to me now, God will never magically spell out for you in a vision or a dream or in some drunken or drug-induced stupor, as some people actually believe. But he'll never reveal his life's will for you in those kind of circumstances. And listen, this might be revolutionary thinking for some of you, but God reveals his purpose and plan and ultimate will for your life through your study and meditation of his word and prayer, which is communing with him. You want to know God's will? You're going to have to get in the book. You want to know God's purpose for your life? You got to stay in the book. So really, how much time are you spending studying and meditating in his word? And are you praying consistently? I'm talking about timely, daily. Or does your praying consist mostly of 911 prayers? A recent poll revealed that most evangelical Christians, 68%, say their time alone with God, when they do have it, consists of reading from a daily devotional guide or email or book and a prayer, and many times the prayer that's prayed is written in the devotional. Now listen, nothing wrong with a devotional, but it should be added to and not in place of an intentionally planned time of studying through passages of Scripture on your own and letting God speak to you personally and not through some devotional writer telling you what God said to them. And there are absolutely some great, let me tell you, great, great, great fringe benefits of committing to that kind of Bible study and prayer. One is you'll fall deeply in love with the Lord Jesus Christ. He'll be the object of your affection. He'll be the centerpiece of your life and marriage. Another is when you dedicate yourself to that kind of study and prayer, you see sin from God's perspective. When you fall in love with Jesus that way, you just see sin the way Jesus sees it. It cost him his life. It cost our Father his Son's life. You see it from God's perspective. And you'll be able to do what Paul says in that verse. Throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And you'll be able to run the race with your eyes fixed on Jesus so that it draws people to him. Now, another benefit to consistent time alone with God in personal Bible study and prayer is you'll have a desire to learn how to become a soul winner. You'll want everyone you know to know what you know, to experience what you have experienced when Jesus Christ saved your soul. You'll want everyone to know that. You'll also want people to understand that sin is a terminal disease apart from Jesus and the cross. And Jesus is the cure, the only cure for that terminal illness of sin. Jesus is the only way to be forgiven and healed of the disease of sin. You tell your friends and your family without hesitation when you get into that kind of relationship with Christ because you have fallen in love with Christ through the Scripture. When you've committed yourself to study and meditation of the Word. One final benefit, there's a lot more that I could name, I don't have time to mention today, but one final benefit to consistent time alone with God in personal Bible study and prayer is how you see and care for His church. I'm going to tell you this morning, unashamedly, church and church membership is important to your Christian life. Church and church membership is important to your Christian life, and here's why. Because church is important to Jesus Christ. He died for the church. That's you and me. We make up the church, not this building, not these grounds. We're the church. He died for the church. And your attitude toward church is a glowing indicator of your relationship to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. Your attitude toward church is a glowing indicator of your relationship to Jesus. But more and more, I'm ashamed and I'm alarmed at the number of Christians who look at church and say, "Nah, I can take it or leave it. I'll just watch it on Facebook if I have time later on or YouTube. Or I'll watch or I might attend on Sunday morning." But I'm going to tell you something, preacher. It is really a big, big ask to get me to come back Sunday night or Wednesday night. Don't you know, preacher, how busy I am? Well, J.C. Penney said, if someone is too busy to attend church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, he's busier than God intended. I didn't say that, J.C. Penney said, but I agree with him. I agree with him. Those are the staples of our church. The church has been meeting on those times since time immemorial. You get involved in some other ministry, that's wonderful. But you ought to be here to support the church. Let me tell you something. When you miss one of those three, Sunday morning, Sunday night, or Wednesday night, do you know you miss, say you miss one of those three. You miss one third of whatever it was that God was imparting to you through a teacher or through the preacher preaching or through a video like we're doing video series on Sunday night. You're missing a third. If you only come on Sunday morning, you're missing two-thirds of what God wants to impart to you for you to know in your life. And you know what happens when that does? When you do like that? Sooner or later, you'll have that fog show up in your life, and you're going to be knocking on my door or somebody's door. I don't know what to do. And you know what I feel like telling people sometimes? If you'd have just been here 3 weeks ago, 2 months ago, we taught on that. Your Sunday school teacher taught a lesson on that. Your preacher preached on that. You wouldn't have to wonder what's going on and why, how you should react and why you should react a certain way. You'd have learned it then. You miss so much when you're not here supporting the meetings of the church. Aren't you glad that Jesus wasn't too busy to carry that cross to Calvary and give his life for you and me? Well, if anybody could have said that, it was him. He never sinned. He didn't have to do that. And what about Sunday school? For many Christians, Sunday school is just a big, big inconvenience. Let me tell you why. It's because of your lack of personal Bible study and prayer time. That's caused you to replace God with idols that become more important to you than he is. And Sunday school and Bible study of any kind, corporate or personal, mean absolutely nothing to you. Nothing. The other things have gotten in the way. The idols have gotten in the way. And if that's you this morning, if you're there this morning, let me tell you what you got. You got an A+ in the devil's grade book. Because he knows that you're not of any use to the kingdom of God, but you are mighty useful to his hellish purposes. If you've gotten to a point where God's word and his church mean nothing to you, Satan has you right where he wants you. And the root cause of everything I just said is a severe lack of personal alone time with God and the study of his word. All right, let me make my way back to Mark and tie all of this in together. Mark is writing to persecuted Christians. Persecuted Christians. They're in the fog of persecution. All they can see is what Nero is doing to them. All they can see is they look around, they see pain. They see family members being killed. They've seen leaders of the church imprisoned, beheaded, and it's difficult on them. They're in that fog. And you remember last week we started this, we talked about they're in the catacombs. They're down underneath the city hiding because they know that if they're caught, they're going to be next to be beheaded. And all they can think about is what's being done to them, the persecution. And so Mark writes this gospel, another Roman Christian, Mark, and he writes to them and he says, get your eyes up. Get your eyes off of the circumstances around you. Get your eyes up and fixed on Jesus. Stop looking at the circumstances. Quit thinking about the persecution. Stop thinking about the pain. Stop fixating on all of that and fixate on the shoreline, the prize. Get your eyes on Jesus. Now, I don't know if that may be a word for some of us in here this morning. Anybody got any fog going on? Anybody got any? Yeah. We all got some fog. And it's easy to get our eyes on the fog and become disoriented, become discouraged. And what a great message. It doesn't matter if you're being persecuted. It doesn't matter what's going on around you. Mark's saying, he's saying the same thing to all of us. Get your eyes off the problem. And get your eyes on Jesus. So let's look at what he says right out of the gate, this letter to these persecuted Christians. They're in the fog, right, of persecution. So let's look how he gets their eyes on Jesus. Look at the beginning there in Mark chapter 1 again. Let me read through that again. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Son of God, as is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I'm sending my messenger before you who will prepare your way. The voice of the one calling out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. And all the country of Judea was going out to him, and all the people of Jerusalem, and they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist. Diet was locust and wild honey. And he was preaching, saying, after me one is coming who is mightier than I, and I'm not fit to bend down and untie the straps of his sandals. I baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. All right, he's talking about the Messiah. That's what's happening and what's going on at that moment regarding John the Baptist and the Messiah. So Mark, is what he's doing really is he's making a sight adjustment here. He's making a sight adjustment for him. He said, let me remind you again of who Jesus is. Maybe you have forgotten. Let me remind you of the gospel, the very promise that we've been believing for. Let me remind you of what we have in the good news. This temporary suffering is not all there is. There's more coming after this life is over. And he's telling them the gospel, only one way to be saved through Jesus Christ. We're just passing through. Heaven is our home. So he's getting their eyes off the fog of persecution and death all around them. And he's saying, let's make a sight adjustment here, get our eyes on Jesus. Then he says, let me do that by reminding you of four important things about the good news, about the only way of salvation through Jesus Christ. He's saying, let me remind you of these four things regarding the gospel. So this morning, if you're in a fog, or if you know someone who's in a fog, you ought to call them, because for the next 3 weeks after this, we're going to talk about each one of these things that are going to help us deepen our faith and help us to stay out of the fog, get out of the fog, but stay out of the fog as well. Again, I told you we're going to take one of these each week. But there are four great things that we're reminded of that will deepen our faith. So here's the first, and the one we'll get to today. Mark is saying, remember, salvation through Jesus Christ was promised in the Bible. Isn't that what he says? It's promised in the Scriptures. He's helping them to get their eyes on Jesus by getting their nose in the Scripture. And I've already said, there's no better way for you to get your eyes on Jesus every single day. I would encourage you early in the morning, get your eyes on Jesus. Someone said, if you run from Jesus in the morning, you'll rarely find him the rest of the day. That's true. How many of us, we don't even think about Jesus maybe until we run into a problem in the course of a day. Or we don't think about Jesus until the end of the day and you're like, oh man, I forgot to pray. I haven't even gotten into God's word today. Well, Mark tells us we have to remember to get our eyes on Jesus and to do that through Scripture. He reminds them, he reminds us today as well, the gospel, the good news, was promised and is promised in the Scripture. And of course, he points all the way back to the Old Testament. Verse 1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as is written in the prophets. So he's pointing to the Old Testament, and he's going to quote two Old Testament prophets, two Old Testament scriptures. He quotes Malachi 3:1, behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way before you. Then he quotes Isaiah 40, verse 3, the voice of one calling out, clear the way for the Lord in the wilderness, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Now, Matthew and Luke and John, they all start their gospel accounts with genealogies. They want to point and help their readers understand where Jesus came from. So Matthew points, because he has a Jewish audience that he's writing to, he wants them to know that this is the Jewish King of Kings that was promised. And so he points all the way back in his genealogy and says that Jesus's lineage goes all the way back to King David. Now that would have been important to Matthew's audience of Jews, because it's prophesied in the Old Testament that the Messiah would come through the line of David. So that's important to Matthew. It's important to his readers and listeners. So he says, listen, I want you to know that Jesus came through the line of David as promised. And so Matthew points to David. Now Luke primarily is writing not to a Jewish audience, but Luke is primarily writing to a Gentile audience. And the Gentiles, in their art and literature, particularly the Greeks, they were always looking for the perfect man. And so Luke says, let me tell you about that perfect man, the sinless Son of God. And Luke's genealogy goes all the way back to the very first man, Adam. And he starts his book that way. Then John comes along and he says, I'm concerned about them knowing that Jesus is God, that he's not just a man, but he is God. So he starts with a divine genealogy. Remember John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, all things come to being through Him, and apart from Him, not even one thing came into being that's come into being. In Him was life, and the life was the light of mankind, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not grasp it. So he's saying, He's God. John said, this is God. He came out of heaven, He put on flesh, He dwelt among us as the God-man. And so these three start with genealogies. The genealogy all the way to Adam or King David or points up and says he's actually from heaven. But Mark starts with no kind of genealogy at all. You know why? Because he's talking about Jesus, the suffering servant. That's what Mark's gospel is all about. Jesus, the suffering servant. And he's talking to suffering Roman Christians. And that's what he wants them to know. He's saying, listen, you have a Savior who suffered with you. He served you. He knows what you're going through right now. He's been through all of it himself. So let me tell you about the servant, Mark says. Now, think about that. Generally speaking, in that day, no one really cared about the genealogy of a servant anyway, right? Nobody cared about a servant's genealogy. Nobody cared about the parents of a servant. Nobody cares where he was born or who he was born to. They only care about what he does. And so that's why Mark primarily dives into Jesus did this, Jesus did that. Remember last week we said his favorite word was what? Immediately, yeah. He just goes from one thing Jesus did to another thing Jesus did to the next thing Jesus did because he's writing about the suffering servant. Two suffering people. And while the other gospel writers point to where Jesus came from, Adam and David and heaven, Mark says, I'm going to point to Scripture because the beginning of the gospel starts hundreds of years ago in your Bible. And he says it first with Malachi and then with Isaiah. So he's saying, let me tell you about the beginning of the gospel. Hundreds of years ago in the Scripture, it was prophesied that the Messiah was coming. So Malachi predicted it 400 years before Christ came. And Isaiah prophesied 700 years before Christ was ever born. And he's telling these suffering Christians, Mark is telling these suffering Christians who are in this fog of persecution. He says, stop for a moment. Why, take a second and remember what's happened. Remember that God has said he's going to send his Messiah, and in front of him, the messenger would come. So he quotes the most famous one here, Isaiah. The words of the Messiah. And then he quotes the last words we have of the Messiah in Malachi. And he jams them together and he says, don't forget. Don't forget, Mark says, you haven't trusted in the wrong one. You haven't trusted in the wrong one. So he quotes about the Messiah and the messenger. Okay? The Messiah and the messenger you read there. Then he goes into talking about John the Baptist and Jesus. You see what he's doing? He's helping them and us to connect the dots. Connect the dots out of the Old Testament into the New Testament. He's quickly connecting those dots without a genealogy, without stretching it out. He says, listen, this was said about the messenger and the Messiah, and guess what? Here they are. Here they are. So he's trying to deepen their faith with the Scriptures rather than with a genealogy. Mark is saying, let me help you make a sight adjustment. See, all they can see is the fog. All they can think about is Nero, who hates Christians. And the sight adjustment is this. Remember, the gospel is God's plan revealed in God's word. You know, it's not as if God says, I didn't see this coming. Man, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to save my people. It's not as if God is saying to us, I have no clue how to reconcile you to myself and make heaven possible for you. No, 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 no. Mark is saying it's not man's invention, but it's God's revelation. What Mark is trying to help them to do that will deepen and strengthen their faith is to assure them that God knew this and planned this, predicted this all along. Listen, church. Here's something that ought to blow our mind. God had a plan to rescue you before you even needed to be rescued. How cool is that? How cool is that? I mean, God knew you're going to be in trouble before you got in trouble, you know? And He planned for it. He promised it. He predicted it. So that when it happened, you would know that it was happening. And folks, for us, that's why it's so important that we get into the Word of God. It's why we have the Scripture. That's why we have the Bible. It's why we have to know what the Old Testament has to say instead of throwing the Old Testament away. There are theologians who are saying, we don't need the Old Testament. We can just get by with the New Testament. That's a lie from the pit of hell. I will tell you this. I know for some people, I understand those Old Testament pages are still stuck together. You know? But that's why you're confused when you get over here in the New Testament. Listen, the New Testament doesn't make sense without the Old Testament. The New Testament is the new covenant that was promised by the Old Testament. So we have to get this. I would dare say your faith and the depth of your faith will be dependent on the depth of understanding you have of Scripture. The more you understand, the deeper you dig. The deeper you dig, the more you find out I don't know. And so you try to dig even deeper to find those nuggets buried deep in the Word of God. And the deeper you dig, the stronger your faith can and will be. Listen, I've heard people say before, you know, a verse a day, a Bible verse a day keeps the devil away. And there's some people who think it's almost superstitious. I better read the Bible or God's going to get mad at me. People think that. They think that. Listen, God's not going to be mad at you if you don't read the Bible. You're just missing out on knowing the heart of God, maybe even missing out on heaven. That's on you. We read the Bible not so we can keep the devil away because he's just so afraid of God's word. Well, he is if we're living out that word. But that's not ultimately why we read and study the word of God. No, listen and hear this. The Bible is either a sword in your hand or a scalpel in God's hand. Not one or the other, but both. Did you get that? The Bible's a sword in your hand, scalpel in God's hand. Not one or the other, but both. You see, the sword, this book, this Bible, this is the sword that helps protect you from the enemy. So that when he comes, you can say, like Jesus did in the desert temptation, "Get behind me, Satan, thus saith the Lord." He quoted Scripture, didn't he? The Bible says, the Scripture says, this is to be a weapon. A sword in the Christian's hand. But let me tell you something. You can tote it around and you can have one as big as a city block underneath your arm if you could tote that around. But if you're not reading it, it doesn't do you one iota of good as you battle Satan in the fog. Amen. It's a weapon, a sword in the Christian's hand. But let me tell you what else it is. It's also a scalpel in God's hand. What do you say? What do you mean, preacher? Well, it's a scalpel for him to cut out the sin in your heart. To cut out the sin in your heart. And I believe that all of us need to let God do a little surgery on us. And let me tell you this. It won't be a one and done surgery either. Not going to be outpatient. In and out. We need to make a surgical appointment for every morning we live with the Lord Jesus Christ to let God remove this highly contagious and aggressive cancer of sin from us day by day. So the depth of your faith will be dependent on the depth of your understanding of Scripture. I'll tell you something. When the fog comes and you don't know this, you don't know what God says, you don't know what the promises of the book are, you don't know how God says to fend off the enemy, doesn't mean that God loves you less, doesn't mean that you're not going to heaven, just means you're going to be lost in the fog. And so many of you get lost in the fog and you don't find your way out. It lingers, it stays there. One fog, it may lift for a brief moment. Then there's another fog to take you over. I want to tell you, your spiritual journey doesn't end when you receive Jesus Christ. It just begins there. Like I said, not knowing the scriptures, that won't send you to hell. But again, your spiritual journey doesn't end when you receive Jesus by faith as Savior and forgiveness of your sin. Jesus desires that we have an abundant life here and now. He even said that. Man, we need the understanding of Scripture to keep us from the peril and consequences of sin, even and especially after we're saved. But too many have decided to live in the fog of life, to live in that sin, which brings discouragement, depression, and defeat to your Christian life, and it'll cause you to trust godly wisdom less and less and human understanding more and more. So hear me, church. Man, our government, society, they do not have answers to the issues of life, the fog that you and I are facing today. But I can tell you this. I promise you, the answer to every issue of life that you will ever face, you'll find the answer of it to it in the Word of God. But here's the thing. It's kind of a catch-22. You got to know the Word of God to find those answers when life throws the fog at you. And so these Christians are struggling. Let me get done with this. These Christians are struggling. Mark says, don't forget what God has said. And what God says, he means. And he means what he says. So grab hold of his promises, Mark says. He says the same thing to us today. Some of you are in the middle of some serious fog. And what I want you to hear today is this. Grab hold of the Scriptures. That's your lifeline. That's the promise of the Word of God. God has said in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not to your own understanding, and all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight. Mark is trying to help us understand that God's Word is faithful. We can depend on it. It's dependable. And yet, how many of us are just totally illiterate to what God has said? And you get lost in that fog. And when you get lost in that fog, sometimes people have the audacity to say, where's God? Why doesn't God help me? Where's God now when I need Him the most? You know what God's saying to you? I'm right here. Black letter on white page. I'm right here. That's what the Lord's saying to you. It's promised, Mark says, in Scripture. It's promised in the book. God promised these things to us, and we're to hold His promises near and dear to our heart. So the very first thing that we see here, the way of salvation, the gospel, the good news of Christ, Mark says it's promised in Scripture. So you got to get your nose in the book if you're going to get your eyes on Jesus. Amen. You know, stats tell us that most churches, less than 10%, most church members, less than 10% read their Bibles on a regular basis. Our daily basis. Is that pathetic or what? Is it any wonder that so many of us stay lost in the fog? Now, I'm not trying to get down on you. I'm not trying to bring you down. In fact, I want to do what Mark does. I want to bring you up. I'm just trying to say, if we know the answer and we don't go for it, we know the answer's in the book and we don't obey it or we don't look for it, then we have no one to blame but ourselves. If you're a believer, I hope what you're hearing is this morning. God's plan is revealed in God's Word, and He wants to strengthen you in it, but you got to feed on the Word. All right, I'm going to end there today, and next week I want us to talk about the way of salvation through Jesus Christ was preached by John the Baptist, and that's that first gospel preacher that I'm talking about. And the other three parts, we'll talk a lot about John the Baptist. But I'm going to stop right there today. And I'm going to make my appeal to all of you who are here and those of you who are watching today. And I want to ask to start with, would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, this invitation time, this time of appeal is in your hands right now. I ask that you have your will and your way and your people in Jesus' name. Amen. My invitation is always first for those who do not know Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. If you're not absolutely sure that if you were to die today that you'd go to heaven, then you need to do some serious, serious work with the Lord Jesus Christ. He gave his life. He died for you. Going to heaven when you die doesn't have anything to do with how good you are in this life. Nothing. You can't work your way into heaven. You'll never be good enough. Your best 15 minutes of being righteous in your whole life won't get you into heaven. Nothing except the blood of Jesus that he shed in your place on that cross. So if you're lost today, say, preacher, I don't like to be called lost. I didn't call you that. That's what the Bible says, what the Lord said. You're lost. You can't find your way. But I'm here to tell you there's a light, and that light is Jesus Christ. And if you'll just trust him, invite him into your life to forgive you of your sins and open your heart to understand his word, and then get into it and get out of the fog. He will save your soul. But that's not where it ends. You just get your ticket to heaven. Jesus said, I've come that you will have an abundant life while you're here now. Oh my. I could be up here all day talking to you about the abundant life, what God has done for me. So could you, many of you. Oh, are there setbacks? Yeah. We all find the fog sometime. We admitted that, right? But listen, the miraculous ways that God brings us through that fog, the things that he does on our behalf, that's the abundant life. That doesn't have anything to do with you having 3 Mercedes in the garage and a $1 million home. In fact, you might have nothing. You might have less after you become a Christian. Less as far as the earth is concerned, but more in glory. And more here, because you're going to have the Lord as your partner, as the one who loves you, standing by your side in every issue of life. One you can trust. If you're not a Christian, maybe you found yourself in some of what I said today. Or if you are a Christian, maybe you found yourself in the fog. And today you would say, Lord, I just want to get out of that fog. I want to trust you. I'm going to start today recommitting myself to reading your scriptures, getting into the book, meditating on the Word of God, and not just 5 minutes of this quickly on the way to work in the car. But I'm going to study your Word, Lord. I'm going to come to church. I'm going to hear your Word. I'm going to Sunday school, and I'm going to be involved in getting to understand your word more and more, Old and New Testament. Maybe that's you today. If that's you, then you mark down your stake today in the ground. Say, today's the day. Devil, you're not going to have your way in my life anymore, because I'm putting the word of God central, focused in my life. And as I told you, there are those great fringe benefits when you do that. You'll fall in love with Jesus all over again. So, Christian, maybe that's what the Lord is asking you to do today. I don't know your heart. Only God does know your heart. But you know, if God's speaking to you right now, it's a dangerous thing not to respond to what God is saying to you, because it gets easier the next time to say no to what the Lord is saying into your life. So let me pray with you, and I'll close this today. But you do in your seat right there what God says that you ought to do based on what you've heard today from his word. Heavenly Father, for those who may be lost today, watching in, those in our sanctuary, I pray, dear God, that you would save their soul. As they pray and invite you into their heart and life and confess their sins and promise, Lord, to live for you the rest of their life, I pray that you'd give them the ability, the power to do just that. For those Christians today, Lord, who would say, you know, Lord, I've got too much fog coming too often in my life, and I need to get shed of it. And to do that, Lord, I know I've got to get more and more into your word. So I'm going to do that starting today, Lord. I'm going to have quiet time with you day by day. I'm going to read the scriptures. I'm going to commune with you in prayer like never before. Father, give them the ability, the desire to do that. And then, Lord, I know what will happen. They'll fall in love with you so deeply that it'll make a difference in every area of their life. So So, Father, that's what we're praying for today as we leave this auditorium. We also, Lord, would be remiss if we didn't pray for the offering that we receive week by week. Again today, Lord, some have already placed their offering in the buckets, but Lord, others will do that before they leave. And I just pray, Father, you would bless what your people give. Use it for your glory. May we use it, Lord, to bring more people into the kingdom of God, not only here locally, Lord, but all around this globe. May you just help us, Lord, to stretch that money into Africa, into the Philippines, into Israel. And Father, people that we may never meet or have that privilege to ever meet, but they might be saved because we were faithful in the tithe, faithful in the offering. So bless it, Lord, in the only way that we know that you can. Go with us now as we leave this building, Lord, until we get back in here at 6 p.m. tonight. And Lord, once again, when we meet together, we'll give you praise and honor and glory for who you are and what you do for us. And then, Lord, also asking that you help us to do what we can for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. I love you. And I'll see you in here tonight at 6 p.m.